FWC's Division of Marine Fisheries Management. Several other FWC staff are joining me today, including Kyle Miller, Lisa Gregg, and Taylor Davis from the Division of Marine Fisheries Management. We also have Captain Scott Pierce from the Division of Law Enforcement to help answer questions. Thank you again for joining us this afternoon. Your participation is important, and we're looking forward to a productive meeting and hearing your input. The purpose of this afternoon's workshop is to gather feedback on potential changes to the Florida Marine Special Activity License Program. The SAL program provides exceptions to state marine fisheries regulations to allow certain activities to occur. This program has been in place for more than 40 years, and this program and the needs of applicants has evolved since then. Rules governing the SAL program have not been updated in the last 15 years. These rules need updates to accommodate new types of activities, streamlined administration of the program, reduce administrative burdens on licensees, and to provide more transparency for applicants. Potential changes will be presented to the FWC Commission in two separate phases. Today, we'll be talking about potential changes to be included in Phase 1. Public feedback gathered during this workshop will inform rule proposals the FWC commissioners will consider at their September 2024 commission meeting. Here's the format for today's workshop. We'll start with a presentation that has an overview of the Marine SAL program, the need for rule changes, and a summary of the potential rule changes to be included in the first phase of this project. After the presentation, we'll have time for questions. And these questions are ones to clarify anything in the presentation about the SAL program and potential rule changes. Once we've gone through questions, we'll take public comment. We appreciate any feedback specific to the potential rule changes, but we'll also accept comments on anything related to the SAL program. When providing your comment, please direct comments to staff only. Will not tolerate personal attacks in this workshop. If you want to ask a question or give a comment, I strongly suggest you use a PC computer or your smartphone. Mac desktop computers and Mac laptops are known to have issues with the microphone unmuting in Microsoft Teams. So if you're on a Mac computer or laptop, I encourage you to switch to your smartphone at this time. If you do not intend to give a comment or ask a question, it's fine if you stay on your Mac device, but otherwise I encourage you switch to a smartphone or a PC computer. Once everyone has had the opportunity to comment, I'll quickly review the next steps for FWC regarding the first phase of potential changes to the SAL program. Our workshop will end at 3 p.m. Eastern Time at the latest. Speaking today is not your only opportunity to provide comments on this topic. If you prefer not to speak, you can provide comments online, on our website, or through email. And the email address is shown on the slide. You can also comment on this item in person at an upcoming commission meeting. I'll make sure to share all the ways to provide public comment again at the end of this workshop. At this point, I'll hand off the presentation to Kyle Miller. Kyle is a biologist in FWC's Division of Marine Fisheries Management based in Tallahassee, Florida.
Thanks, Erica. I'll begin with some information about the Marine SAL program. So the program began in 1981 under the former Florida Department of Natural Resources. And this program was established to allow activities that would not otherwise be possible under state marine fisheries rules. And it authorizes activities that benefit Florida while ensuring that our living marine resources receive the appropriate protections they need. For example, activities that are in the state's best interest but are not allowed under current marine fisheries regulations would include the operation of restoration nurseries, exhibition of prohibited shark species in a public aquarium, and the relocation of organisms from like a planned construction area to an area where there won't be disturbed by any construction activities. SALs can also be used to authorize the collection of prohibited species, waive season restrictions, size or bag limits, and authorize the use of gear that's normally prohibited. FWC staff review each of these applications to ensure that the requested activities can be conducted appropriately and would not have any unnecessary or unintended impacts. FWC insight or oversight and regulation over these activities is important because these activities may involve prohibited species and prohibited gear. And if these activities are not conducted appropriately, they could negatively affect Florida's living marine resources. The staff review applications and issue about 400 SALs every year. And we have 11 different types of licenses to accommodate a wide range of activities, including scientific research, education, exhibition, the release of marine organisms, collection of broodstock for aquaculture purposes, testing of innovative gear, use of non-conforming gear, and certain commercial fishing activities. The complete list of the types of licenses that we issue is listed on this slide. All right, as Erica mentioned earlier, the SAL rules were last revised 15 years ago. And in that time, requested activities in recent years have expanded and rule changes are needed to meet evolving program needs and to accommodate current or new practices that are not directly addressed by current SAL rules. Some examples of these expanded activities would include coral rescue and restoration related to disturbance events like disease and thermal stress, rehabilitation to address situations like the recent Florida Keys abnormal fish behavior event, or the harvest of rooted marine plants to be used as broodstock in aquaculture in support of habitat restoration projects, and establishment of restoration nurseries for multiple species. So additional rule changes are needed to streamline the administration of the program, reduce administrative burdens on licensees, and to provide more transparency for applicants. So we've identified a series of potential changes that would improve the operation of the program and plan to present these proposals to the commission in two separate phases. Today, we'll discuss a suite of proposals to be included in the first phase of the project, which is the green box on the left of the screen, which includes things like general rule updates, streamlining FWC law enforcement notification process, extending a license period for three different types of SALs, expanding license options for some educators, and repealing the dredge SAL. Topics that may be considered for changes during phase two include streamlining reporting requirements, addressing the transfer and tagging of marine organisms, reviewing and updating incorporated policies, pulling rule language for non-conforming gear SALs out into separate rules for each of the license types, and reviewing the provisions and requirements for five additional SAL types. Items listed on the slide for phase two are really just ideas at this point and may change. But we expect to bring some proposed rules for phase two to the commission next year. Today, we'll be focusing on potential items to be included in phase one. There are a series of potential changes that would apply to the general provisions of the SAL rule chapter. This includes removing outdated and unnecessary rule language related to general eligibility requirements and the issuance, renewal, denial, and revocation of FWC-issued licenses, which is now addressed by an agency-wide permitting rule. Other unnecessary language, such as internal review processes, would also be removed. Currently, no more than 10 personnel, in addition to a licensee, may conduct activities authorized by most SALs. This limit is really no longer necessary and can be removed. And removing this will allow licensees to determine how many additional personnel are needed to conduct authorized activities under their SAL. Because these licenses provide exceptions to the rules, licensees are required to notify FWC law enforcement 24 hours before conducting SAL-related activities. Currently, a licensee must call the FWC dispatch center for the area where the activities will occur and relay specific information about their trip to a dispatcher. We'd like to streamline this notification requirement and process by providing a licensees with a centralized point of contact within law enforcement who will then disseminate the information appropriately to the field. Licensees would be able to provide this notification via email. A third-party contractor is a person or business that's hired to provide services to collect and or transport marine organisms on behalf of a licensee. These contractors are primarily used to collect for public aquariums under an education exhibition SAL or for researchers under a scientific research SAL. We're proposing to limit the use of a third-party contractor to the scientific research, education exhibition, and governmental purpose SALs only, as they aren't really a good fit under the other license types, such as SOC collection release SAL, which requires certain expertise. We're also considering updating definitions to correspond with potential rule changes, which would include terms like genetic conservation unit, mitigation, nursery, release, etc. A scientific research SAL. This license accommodates the needs of the scientific community to conduct research that would enhance the greater body of knowledge in support of fisheries management, resource conservation and enhancement, and public health. For scientific research SALs that are issued for non-prohibited species, we would propose extending the maximum license period from 3 years to up to 5 years. We also are proposing to move the licensing of restoration and mitigation activities out from underneath the scientific research SAL and move that to the stock collection and release SAL, where it's more appropriately handled. The education exhibition SAL allows collection of marine organisms in support of marine education activities, as well as the harvest for and the exhibition of organisms at public aquariums to increase the public's knowledge and awareness of Florida's marine resources. For this license, we're proposing to extend the maximum license period involving non-prohibited species from 1 year to 3 years. We would also propose to providing educators with an option to apply for either the education exhibition SAL or a FIMSI certification. Currently, an educator that meets the eligibility requirements to apply for a FIMSI certification is not eligible to apply for the education exhibition SAL. The FIMSI certification requires an applicant to pay for, attend, and complete a training workshop that's conducted by a non-FWC entity. This change would allow educators to apply for the general exemptions that are provided by a FIMSI certification or to apply for the education exhibition SAL, which can be more tailored to a specific need or request. Extending the maximum license periods for these SALs would reduce the administrative burden on licensees. The aquaculture broodstock collection SAL allows for the harvest and possession of marine organisms to be used as broodstock for aquaculture research or commercial aquaculture. We're proposing to extend the maximum license period for this license from 1 year to 2 years to reduce the administrative burden associated with renewals. Because FWC has the framework in place to review and license these restoration activities, Florida Department of Environmental Protection and the Florida Department of Agriculture and Consumer Services requested FWC modify the aquaculture broodstock collection SAL to allow the collection of rooted marine plants as broodstock to support habitat restoration projects throughout the state for things like seagrass restoration. This would streamline the review and approval of activities needed to support these restoration projects, while ensuring that these broodstock collections can occur without impacting wild populations. To implement this change, we would propose to modify the purpose of the ABC SAL to include restoration activities and to modify the eligibility requirements for this license to ensure that licensees collecting rooted marine plants maintain a valid certificate of nursery registration issued by Department of Agriculture and Consumer Services. The dredge SAL was created to monitor the commercial harvest of clams and mussels using dredges, a harvesting gear that's not otherwise allowed to harvest shellfish under current fisheries regulations. Only one dredge SAL has been issued in the last 10 years, and the most recent license was issued in 2015. We're proposing to repeal the dredge SAL since it's no longer needed. Now I'd like to hand the presentation over to Lisa Gregg to discuss potential changes to the SCR, Stock Collection Release SAL. Lisa is a program and policy coordinator in FWC's Division of Marine Fisheries Management, and she's also based here in Tallahassee. Lisa's having some technical difficulties with her computer, so she'll take over from my computer.
Hi, everyone. And talk about the stock collection and release SAL. And this license is intended to ensure that activities involve the collection or release of marine organisms for purposes such as restoration, mitigation, scientific research, and rehabilitation are conducted in a way that preserves the health and genetic diversity of wild populations. Currently, the stock collection release SAL rule is focused on the collection of broodstock and the release of captive bred or reared offspring. But in recent years, the requested activities involving collections and releases have expanded to include opportunistic and rescue collections, relocations for research and mitigation, restoration, rehabilitation. Because these activities go beyond just a basic broodstock collection release of animals, we propose amending the purpose of the SAL, the stated purpose in the rule, to directly address these activities and to ensure that they're conducted successfully while preserving the health and genetic diversity of wild populations. Proposed changes to the stock collection release SAO will support the restoration of species like coral, oysters, and other species. For all activities requesting to release marine organisms pursuant to an SERSAL, the risk of potential impacts to the genetic diversity of wild stocks is evaluated using a standardized decision-making process that was incorporated into rule as a flowchart back in 2009. So we're proposing to update this flowchart that's been expanded, and additional information has been added to provide more transparency and better assist the applicants with understanding how FWC evaluates the potential risk of requested activities. So the application form for the SERSAL will also need to be updated to reflect the potential changes, reflect these potential changes and other ones that are reflected in the next two slides. So to ensure that applicants are qualified to conduct these expanded activities, the SERSAL eligibility requirements need to be updated. These changes would require applicants to have appropriate experience and veterinary support necessary to successfully conduct requested activities. Under the potential rule changes, an applicant requesting to release marine organisms for relocation activities must have documented experience conducting successful restoration activities with marine organisms relating to the subject matter of the proposed activity, including subsequent monitoring after relocation. An applicant requesting to conduct releases associated with holding, production, outplanting, rehabilitation, those kind of activities, would need to have a minimum of 2 years husbandry experience with the requested species. Additionally, an applicant requesting to conduct land-based nursery-related activities would also be required to establish and maintain a veterinary client-patient relationship, or a VCPR, with a USDA APHIS Category 2 accredited veterinarian who is trained to conduct health certification examinations and visual health assessments relating to the subject matter of the proposed activity. So these changes would eliminate the need for a licensee to be issued a release authorization prior to releasing marine organisms pursuant to an SERSAL, reducing administrative burden on the licensee and ensuring that release activities are not unnecessarily delayed and can occur in a timely manner. To effectively authorize and manage diverse requests to conduct release activities, we propose adding license conditions to the rule that are appropriate to requested activities. These conditions would include requiring adherence to processes and protocols established for genetic and health management, inspections, monitoring, and reporting. For example, this would include protocols for the management of in-water coral nurseries and protocols for the management of coral outplanting, which has been developed in close coordination with the Florida Keys National Marine Sanctuary and restoration practitioners. License conditions related to genetic management are intended to ensure all release activities are conducted within the same genetic conservation unit as the parent source stock for the subject species. Health management conditions incorporate health certification exams, visual health assessments, threshold criteria to determine when immediate response or corrective actions are required, changes environmental conditions like water temperature, disease prevalence, predators, competitors, transportation requirements, things like container size, spacing, water temperature, dissolved oxygen content or length of transport, and maintenance requirements, like biofouling, overgrowth, overcrowding, and removal of dead or diseased animals. These conditions also include requirements for inspections, monitoring, and reporting. So back to Kyle for a summary of potential changes under consideration for phase one.
Thank you, Lisa. That's a lot of information to go over. So to recap, we've discovered several different potential changes that could be included in the first phase of this project, such as removing outdated and unnecessary rule language, removing the limit to the number of authorized personnel, streamlining the FWC law enforcement notification process for licensees, specifying that third-party contractors are eligible to operate only under the scientific research, education, exhibition, and governmental purpose SALs, updating and adding new definitions to correspond with rule changes, extending the maximum license period for the scientific research SAL to 5 years, education exhibition to 3 years, and aquaculture broodstock collection to 2 years. Also, moving restoration and mitigation activities from under the scientific research SAL to stock collection release SAL, allowing educators to apply for either the education exhibition SAL or FMC certification, updating eligibility criteria for the aquaculture broodstock collection SAL to accommodate collections of rooted marine plants as broodstock for restoration, repealing the dredge SAL, revising stock collection release SAL eligibility requirements, conditions, and application form to expand the scope of activities that may be authorized under this license, and updating the genetic risk assessment decision process flowchart to provide additional information and transparency for applicants. And that concludes the informational portion of the workshop. Now I will hand it over to Erica to lead us through questions.
Thank you, Kyle and Lisa. As Kyle said, we'll now take questions on the presentation and the topic of the Marine SAL program updates. If you'd like to ask a question, please use the raise hand function in Microsoft Teams. When I call on you, you'll have the ability to unmute yourself. Please unmute yourself by clicking on the microphone icon. After asking your question, please mute yourself by clicking the microphone icon a second time. I'll then direct your question to the appropriate FWC staff in attendance. Please be respectful of all speakers. Not everyone shares the same perspective, but everyone has the right to speak their opinion. Personal attacks of any kind are unacceptable. This time is reserved for questions only, and we want to be sure to have plenty of time for comments later. Because of this, I'll limit the time for questions to 20 minutes. We have 70 people in attendance, and so not being sure yet how many people want to speak, we want to make sure we give the maximum number of people the opportunity to ask their questions and give their comments. So I'll begin by calling on the first person who has their hand raised. If you'd like to ask a question, please use the raise hand function. First person with a question is Andrew Baker. Go ahead, Andrew.
It seemed not. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, it seems I can't control my own microphone. So thanks for the presentations. I think they were pretty informative, and I welcome some of the changes, especially the ones to do with the extension of the duration of some of these SALs to avoid reapplying on a very frequent basis and reduce the workload on FWC staff. And hopefully a lot of these changes will streamline things. I did have a question, which is that there's a document that's been produced by FWC about genetic risk assessment and conservation management for Florida's corals. And although it wasn't explicitly mentioned in this presentation, I guess my question are the changes that are being outlined here going to include the institution of that document into the new sort of rules and recommendations, or is that really a separate process from what's being outlined here?
Thank you for your question, Andrew. I'd like Lisa to respond. Go ahead, Lisa.
Hey, Andrew. Yes. So there's kind of a stepwise process. So the current SAL rule has a very like 10,000 foot level genetic risk assessment process. And because of that, when coral restoration started really kicking up, you know, 2014, 2015, a lot of folks were asking, you know, how do our activities with coral fit into this risk assessment, because it is at that 10,000 foot level. So that's kind of what preceded us, you know, or urged us to go ahead and do a coral specific genetic document. And in that genetic document, we have basically the same flowchart that we currently have in rule, but it has been significantly expanded to specifically address coral restoration activities and or genetic risk activities. So so it's basically just that expanded flowchart, and that we expanded specifically for corals to provide more information to the practitioners, to the applicants, or whoever's going to look at it, or whoever needs it, so they can follow their activities. And but that expanded flowchart, we are going to, then the third step is kind of just generalize it again to, so that it applies to all species. And that last flowchart, that's the one that's going to be used as and updated into the rule to replace the current one that we have. Does that answer your question?
Yes, I think. Thanks, Lisa. Yeah, I think it generally does. I'm just wondering, obviously there's a separate process, for example, with the genetics working group commenting or providing feedback on that document. Should we use the public comment that's part of this session and following this session to also comment on that, or would you prefer that those things are kept separate?
Andrew, what I would prefer is that once we generalize that, we were waiting for the comments back from that document to see if we needed to change that that flowchart at all or modify it before we generalized it for all species. So once we generalize it, and that will be made available, and you can comment on it that way.
Got it. Okay, thanks.
Okay.
Thank you, Lisa. And Andrew, thank you for your question. Is there anyone else who has a question? I see Dawn with her hand raised. Dawn, you should be able to unmute yourself and please ask your question. Don, somewhere on your screen, you should see something that looks like a microphone. Oh. Don has put her hand down. Is there anyone else who has a question? I see Tanya Wiley with their hand raised. Tanya, go ahead and unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hi, thank you for the presentation. And thank you for proposing to extend the sale period for non-prohibited species from 3 to 5 years. My question is, does that mean that the sales for prohibited species will stay 1 year periods?
Tanya, thanks for your question. Lisa, go ahead.
Hey, Tanya. Yes, at this time, we're still maintaining the 1 year license period for prohibited species. And the reason for that is because of primarily education exhibition. If you're doing scientific research, you've been able to request, to request to harvest or to work with prohibited species at any point in time throughout the year. But for education exhibition, there is a quota, and they apply twice a year for prohibited species if they want to collect them. And so in order to maintain that quota, we have to have certain timeframes for application and issuance, and the quotas are yearly quotas, so we've got to maintain that 1 year time frame.
Thank you, Lisa. Tanya, did you have a follow-up question?
No, that answered my question. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who has a question? I see Kylie Smith. Kylie Smith, you should be able to unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yeah, thank you. I actually have two questions coming from the coral restoration practitioner side. The first question has to do with the experience requirement, saying that it's by species. So I'm just curious if I feel like restoration is starting to encompass new species all the time, especially those that come from maybe rescue projects, from, you know, transportation projects or those. So can you give a little bit more information about what that experience is, and if it's just in coral restoration, you know, practices in general, or if it's with specific species?
Kylie, thanks for your question. I think this one is also for Lisa.
Yes. Hey, Kylie. That's a very good question. I agree that, when we're talking about 2 years of husbandry experience with the requested species, we're more talking about like coral in general, or crabs in general, or oysters in general, that kind of thing. So I think that if you can, establish that you've got if you have husbandry experience, especially with corals, you're going to be working with urchins and other species. So it's not a far stretch to say that, you know, your experience with those species would technically include like urchins or some of those other reef associated species. So I think that's a good point, and we'll try and make sure that the rule language clarifies and provides for that.
Great, thank you. My other question had to do talking about removing the requirement for a release authorization and instead requiring the veterinary client-patient relationship. And I'm sorry if I missed it, but can you give a little bit more information on what that relationship looks like and what you're looking for?
Sure, Kylie. So a lot of what's getting put into the stock collection and release rule, I'm sure a lot of the coral practitioners on this call are like, well, we're already doing this. What's really going to change for us? I can tell you that there isn't much that's going to change at all for coral restoration practitioners. So this is something that all of the coral restoration practitioners that are operating in a land-based facility, they all already have a veterinary client-patient relationship established with a with a vet. So this is something that has already been tried and through the coral restoration, practitioners to ensure that this would work so that we could get rid of the release authorization. So like in your situation, because you utilize Keys Marine Lab, you would be using Dr. Ari because he's already the facility's veterinarian. So in that situation, you'd be covered. Does that answer your question?
It does. Thank you so much.
Great. Thanks, Kylie and Lisa. Next we have, and I'm sorry, the name is cut off partially for me, Fanor Montoya Maya. You should be able to unmute yourself and ask her a question.
Yeah, I did. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. First of all, thank you very much, Lisa, Cal, and everyone else from FWC for this informative session and the suggested changes. I think it's, I really welcome those, seconding everyone else's comments. I have one clarifying question. So in our case, Coral Restoration Foundation, we have an in-situ gene bank and several production nurseries. Under that scenario, and with the suggested changes of coral restoration moving to the aquaculture blue stock collection and the stock collection and release, does it mean that, for instance, for gene bank, we will have to apply for the aquaculture blue stock collection, and for production, we will need to apply for the stock collection and release?
Thank you, Fanor. So Lisa, a question about what SAL would be appropriate for these activities.
Yeah, thanks. Hey, Fanor. So the stock collection and release is exactly what it says, stock collection and release. So no, you would not have to apply for aquaculture broodstock collection, the ABC. That one is specifically primarily for commercial aquaculture operations. And we have extended it at the request of a couple other agencies to accommodate a few restoration activities where that we would not be managing post collection of the broodstock, like for seagrasses. So yes, the stock collection and release, which is what you have now, that is the only license you would need to apply for.
Thank you.
Thank you both. Next up is Aaron. Aaron, you should be able to unmute yourself. Aaron, there should be a microphone icon somewhere in your screen, either in one of the top corners or down on the bottom. And if you select that icon, you'll be unmuted and you can ask your question. Aaron, if you are unable to find the microphone icon to unmute yourself, you can email us your question to marine@myfwc.com. Also, if you happen to be on a Mac desktop computer or laptop, we know they have issues connecting with Microsoft Teams. If you are on a Mac desktop or laptop, please leave this meeting and join through your smartphone or another device, and you should resolve those microphone issues. Are there any other questions? Seeing none, we'll move into our public comment session. This part of the workshop is where we'd appreciate your input on potential SAL program changes presented this afternoon and other suggestions for the SAL program that you may have. As we did with questions, please use the raise hand function in Microsoft Teams to indicate that you'd like to speak. I'll go down the list in order of when you raise your hand, and then when you're called upon, click the microphone icon to unmute yourself and provide public comment. Once finished, please click the microphone icon again and you'll be muted. To allow the greatest number of commenters, we'll ask that you keep your remarks to 2 minutes or less. If we have a large number of people who raise their hand to provide comment, we may need to limit comment times further to allow everyone the opportunity to speak. We'll recognize each speaker once for a comment. If you're with a group of people, then each person who'd like to provide a comment will need to join the meeting from a separate device. When it's your turn to provide comment, please state your name and affiliation for the record. You'll see a timing light on the screen. It will start as green and then switch to yellow when you have 30 seconds remaining, and then turn to red when your allotted time is up. If you have microphone issues or your computer does not have a microphone, please email your comment to marine@myfwc.com, which is shown on the bottom of the screen. Also, if you're on an Apple computer, we recommend you switch to a smartphone to join the meeting. This has resolved microphone issues in the past. We'll end this meeting at 3 p.m. Eastern Time at the latest, and we'll allow as many speakers as possible to provide comments until then. With that, let's go to our first speaker. So the first hand I see raised is for Ann Schaffner. Ann, unmute yourself and please provide your comment.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Oh, great. Thank you. I just wanted to comment on the law enforcement notification process. I have found that when you call law enforcement, sometimes the individual on the other end doesn't seem well versed in what the SAL process or what an SAL is. And I know you guys have been working on educating the law enforcement folks about that through the years. I just wondered if there could be a better streamlined process, whether it be a text message type process where you could send, your SAL number, the boat that you're on, time on the water, to where it goes to like a central location, as opposed to each regional law enforcement office. I've just found that it's not always sometimes seems that they are not very familiar with it, and just trying to make that easier would be something I would like you guys to look into. That was all.
And thanks for your comment. Streamlining the law enforcement notification process is part of this rule package. And so hopefully we're able to bring some of the suggestions you have into practice. If you could, actually, I just confirmed that we have your contact information. So Lisa and Captain Scott Pierce with our law enforcement group will follow up with you to provide you more details on what the new process would look like after this meeting. Is there anyone else who has a question? I'm sorry, I said question, I meant comment. Please raise your hand if you'd like to offer a comment on this proposed rule. The next hand I see up is Bobby Renfro. Bobby, go ahead and unmute yourself and provide your comment.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Oh, excellent. I do apologize. I am on a Mac and it did take a minute. So my comment was in regard to the notification of law enforcement as well. You don't have to answer if it's possible, but one comment that I would have would be it might be easier for people that are doing repetitive activities to be able to submit notification for several days in a row at one time, rather than it being a day-by-day basis.
Thank you for that suggestion, Bobby. We appreciate it. And I'm glad you were able to join, even though you are on a Mac. We do regret that that's an issue. We do have someone on staff who would like to clarify the proposal. So Lisa or Kyle, would you like to do that?
Yeah, so that is one of the things that we are proposing this time is to streamline the law enforcement notification process because of that issue where, you know, duty officers change and these people are dispatchers for law enforcement and may not be well-versed in all the aspects of the agency and, you know, there's turnover and all that stuff. So we are proposing a centralized notification process where you would submit all your information into an email. And we're going to work on a form to show what data fields you need to provide. But you would be able to just send one email to one email address, and then FTC law enforcement would disseminate that information to the appropriate field. And we've discussed about making it valid for a week if you needed to do it that way.
Thank you, Kyle. I appreciate the clarification. Bobby, did you have another comment based on that clarification?
No, sorry, Bobby. I didn't realize my hand didn't go down automatically.
All right, thank you. Is there anyone else who'd like to offer a comment? I'm not seeing any other hands from the audience. So I will assume that there are no comments, other comments to be made at this time. I do not assume that doesn't mean that you don't want to comment on this rule. So let me show you some other ways that you can provide comment and go over the next steps. We thank you guys for joining us today. We appreciate you taking time out of your busy schedules to join us. We'll continue to gather public feedback on the SAL program updates. So if you or someone you know would like to provide additional comments, there are more opportunities to weigh in. You can email marine@myfwc.com, or you can go online to our website at myfwc.com/saltwatercomments and leave us some feedback there. We will summarize the feedback gathered during this workshop and through the additional feedback channels and present a summary of that feedback along with our proposed rule recommendations to the FWC commissioners for consideration at the September 2024 commission meeting. Again, we appreciate your feedback and time today. Your participation is important, and we will be taking it into consideration when developing our final proposed rule recommendations for the commission. This concludes today's workshop, and thank you again for joining us. Have a great day.